As is always the case with my reviews of sequels, spoilers for prior seasons are fair game, though I will try to avoid mentioning them wherever possible. Enjoy. Roughly a year and a half ago, I created two reviews for JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, covering the first 2012 season, comprised of parts 1 and 2, and then Stardust Crusaders, the much longer part 3. Both have gone on to become some of my most popular and, judging by the liked-dislike ratio, most controversial videos. Considering that, I'd be crazy not to review part 4, Diamond is Unbreakable, and it just so happens that it finished its run approximately 1 month ago. So once again, I've saddled up, ready to say my piece and brave whatever fire JoJo fans throw my way. Although this time, I don't think they'll have nearly as much to be upset about. Let's do this. Had it followed the pattern up to this point, Diamond is Unbreakable would tell the tale of Kujo Jotaro's grandson in the year 2049, 50 years after Stardust Crusaders. However, perhaps not wanting to reach too far into the future, Araki changed the game this time, with Part 4 taking place only 10 years after Part 3, or in other words, the year 1999, in the quiet small town of Morio. Our new Jojo is the 16-year-old Higashikata Josuke, a bastard son of Joseph Joestar, and therefore half-uncle to Jotaro, complete with his own stand in at this point typical JoJo fashion. I'm not sure where you get the eponymous JoJo from his name, but we can't worry about such trivial details. Josuke is going about his normal high school days, wicked hairdo and all, when he's approached by the one, the only, the worst JoJo. I mean, Kujo Jotaro. Jotaro is on the hunt for a stand-using murderer, a murderer who, coincidentally, goes on to target the Higashikata family. Without all that much trouble, the two Jojos defeat their opponent, but discover that he acquired his stand abilities after being stabbed by a mysterious bow and arrow. In their hunt for this weapon, the two must contend with other newly created stand users, making allies and enemies along the way, before finally being embroiled in a devious plot by a dastardly serial killer, whose ominous presence threatens the very peace and happiness of the people of Morio. The first thing to make clear is that for all the changes that Part 4 brings, JoJo is still JoJo. The series still embraces an over-the-top cheesiness with bombastic characters, outrageous stand fights, and a smattering of simply, well, bizarre entities, from ghosts and intelligent rats to spiky-headed little boys. But just because some things have stayed the same doesn't mean they all have. Naokatsu Tsuda has served as the director of each and every JoJo's series, of those produced by David Production, but it feels like he decided to stretch his creative muscle a little more with Diamond is Unbreakable. The most obvious and immediate example of this would be the unique color palette. Prior seasons of the series would be known to shift into eye-catching colors during moments of high tension or excitement, but this is the first time that the show's default look is noticeably different, color-wise. Take a look at a shot from Stardust Crusaders. There's certainly some stylization, but the setting is, by and large, realistically represented. Not exactly so here, with a near-ubiquitous use of slightly off-tone yellows, greens, and purples. It certainly takes some getting used to compared to the prior parts, but this creates a very vibrant, funky, and memorable identity for the season, daring you not to forget it thanks to its unusually striking spectrum of color. The color work alone, though, is not the only visual change, with the character design as well, undergoing a somewhat radical shift between arcs, as is par for the course with David Production. Sadly, that means we've lost the Hellspawn Muscle Man aesthetic of Stardust Crusaders, but I guess times change. I don't have anything especially good or bad to say about the style. The noses take a little getting used to, but otherwise in my eyes it's just a style. I don't hate the change, but neither do I especially love it. But I do love what they do with some subtle stuff, little creative bits of directing and scene transitions. Were you paying attention to the video just now? Because one just happened. Here, I'll back up. This scene starts with Jotaro on the phone in his hotel room. Upon finishing his call, he heads out to grab a taxi, but rather than showing him walk out and hop in as most other anime or media in general would do, he just kind of sits down into the taxi. The beauty of it is that it's so quick and subtle, you might not even notice it if you aren't paying full attention. And there are a lot of transitions like this in the series, though that one's probably my favorite, with most others being something along the line of an item entering the shot and its background fading in afterwards. Little tidbits like that, of course, won't make or break a show, but they illustrate a higher degree of passion and creativity than your average run-of-the-mill adaptation. The best way to describe the actual plot of Diamond is Unbreakable is really like a JoJo slice of life, strange as it sounds. For much of the series, especially in the middle third, there's no real tangible goal for our characters to work towards. They're just living their lives and happen to come across new stand users as a matter of course. Naturally, these stand abilities are as wacky and interesting as ever, but I really liked just how the users were presented. Unlike Stardust Crusaders, where every stand user after Polnareff was an enemy sent by Dio, the majority of stand users here are just residents of Morio that happen to stumble into stand abilities. Some of them might attack our cast, but it's not often under the orders of some higher power. Maybe they're just an animal or a baby, because this time, animals and babies actually act like animals and babies. You won't see any Iggies or Mannish Boys here. Rats will be rats, and cats will be cats. Or, if they are an adult human, maybe it's just because they feel threatened or endangered. Maybe it's because they're just a dick. Maybe they're not even enemies at all, which refreshingly happens several times. Some of them aren't even stand users. The variety is what sells it here. Very, very few of the stand users our heroes encounter are through and through evil. They're all basically just people with the goodness and badness that regular people have, and because of that, death between stand users is relatively rare, so most of them continue to live in Morio afterward. This is also the benefit of basing the entire story in a small town rather than chartered out over the length of a road trip. People can come up again and again without it feeling forced. If you recall, one of my fundamental complaints with Stardust Crusaders was that many of the episodes ultimately felt like filler, one-off stand battles with little to no lasting weight or depth. At the beginning of the arc, the goal was to kill Dio. 50 episodes later, they killed Dio, with the majority of episodes in between serving no particular function but to show off a cool fight. I am pleased to say this is anything but the case with Diamond is Unbreakable. There is still a stand of the week setup, and there are still some filler characters that, in the grand scheme of things, serve very minor or non-existent roles, but it takes care to ensure that this rarely feels like an active issue, and the technique for this is twofold. Firstly, several of the fights establish something new and important for our main cast, and most of the weekly characters come back to be relevant in some way to future episodes. Whether it's serving as a character introduction, character development, or some sort of stand upgrade, very rarely is a battle entirely meaningless. And even if it is, it doesn't feel as detrimental to the experience because, unlike Part 3, there is rarely a specific goal that the plot is supposed to be building towards in the first place. When there's no larger threat hanging over everyone's heads, it's a hell of a lot easier to just enjoy episodes that serve no other purpose than to have fun with the characters. Which is great, because the characters themselves are... As I mentioned, there are a number of people that flit in and out of the story, but there is most definitely a main cast, the first of which naturally being JoJo, or Josuke. Josuke is friendly and kind, but he acts his age, not above a little bit of mischief, and having little trouble being brusque or violent once attacked or insulted. His stand ability is convenient without being overpowered, able to heal any injuries or damage to any organism or object other than himself. The cast is rounded out by the lovably stupid Okuyasu, the meek and gentle Koichi, and the ever-stoic Jotaro. And one more, introduced a little later, who is by far my personal favorite, Kishibe Rohan, a cynical, angry, proud, suave, smart, loner, bastard mangaka. And by God, do I love him. To the point that I actually got a little depressed upon hearing that he would have no significant role in any future JoJo's. At a point relatively near the end of the series, things do take a turn. All the relevant characters have been introduced, and it's time for the climax. Thankfully, this is a damn good climax, probably one of my favorite chunks of anime I've seen in a while, if not for a couple of issues unrelated to the story, which I'll come back to. For one, without spoiling what happens, it was actually rather emotional. It had my heart in a vice, my chest felt tight watching some very appropriately tense scenes involving these characters I had grown to cherish. And for two, I was worried because in this stretch, the threat was not proverbial. People died, and they died hard and fast. This endgame also brings with it its own excellent new characters, chiefly Yoshikage Kira, a serial killer who just wants to live a quiet life, and Best Boy Hayato, a completely normal kid who just happens to be caught up in all this shit. I've never been one to love the background JoJo soundtrack in any of the seasons. I've liked and remember them well enough to appreciate the fact that the Stardust Crusaders battle theme played whenever Jotaro fought, but my overall musical experience with JoJo was dominated by the openings and the endings, a tradition which Part 4 did not flub. Each of the three openings is visually standout, for some reason ditching the CGI that JoJo openings are known for, but packed with tons of color and interesting imagery, sometimes both. Musically, I'm not the hugest fan of the second, but the first and especially third I really like. But of course I have to specifically address the credits theme, since JoJo has built a bit of a reputation for itself in this department, with its use of songs like Roundabout and Walk Like an Egyptian in earlier seasons. The credits theme for part 4 is I Want You by Savage Garden, which I enjoyed as much as I was able. There's only the one theme, which slightly disappointed me considering the series' fairly long length of 39 episodes, but I suppose beggars can't be choosers. Some of the things that could come off as bad I've already mentioned. Much of the show's middle section has no clearly defined end goal and consists of the characters simply going about their lives and meeting new stand users along the way, with no clear greater purpose to these actions other than introducing characters for the sake of them existing later on. And it starts to slip into its bad habits of filler stand fights in the last third. But more than that, where the show really struggled was in its animation. I already praised the design work and that's not what I'm talking about here, I mean the actual technical merits of the animation, because they are probably the weakest they've ever been. The continuous three-core broadcast schedule just gave the production zero room to breathe, and it shows, with a consistent lack of motion and frequently under-detailed or off-model drawings, sometimes stunting moments that should have felt a lot more epic. The Blu-rays will fix this, but honestly, only to an extent. Unless your company is Shaft, it's not common practice to entirely rework scenes for the home video release, so while we might see a few more on-model characters, I don't think the overall quality of movements and the like will improve all that much. Of course, they squeeze as much animation as they can into the scenes where it really counts, but this is to the clear detriment of other, less important material. Secondly, not that JoJo's is especially known for its tight-knit writing consistency, but sometimes it seems as if the characters somehow forget the extent of their abilities, for the sake of heightened tension and suspense. For instance, in a fight relatively near the end of the series, Josuke is trapped by a pylon, a power pylon. The way this battle works is not that the pylon will attack him, but rather that it will turn him into metal if he leaves its borders. This is a battle that goes on for 2 to 3 episodes, I forget which, and it's not a bad battle, until you realize one glaring flaw. Right outside the pylon, trying to help, is Okuyasu, who at one point has his stand punch the pylon to no avail, neglecting that his stand also has the uncanny ability to wipe from existence anything that touches the palm of its right hand. So that begs the question, why didn't he just delete away the pylon and be done with it? Well, because that wouldn't be a very interesting fight. Now that was the clearest example I could think of, and it's a simple product of this kind of storytelling, with constant over-the-top fantastical superpowers. You're going to run into situations where it just doesn't make complete sense that characters are having as much trouble as they are, but you just have to roll with it for the sake of drama and fun. It didn't really fit mentioning it anywhere else, but Diamond is Unbreakable has more manga chapters but significantly less anime episodes than Stardust Crusaders, so the pacing is pretty nice and snappy. That, in addition to the entertaining characters, slice-of-life-esque story elements, powerful plot climaxes, extravagant stand fights, and engrossing visual concepts, Part 4 is a very strong showing for the now 30-year-old manga series turned anime. So after taking everything into account, as well as my own subjective enjoyment on a scale from F to S, it just nearly fell short of that highest echelon, but I will say, JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, Diamond is Unbreakable, easily deserves an A rating. I'm going to miss the Town of Morio, because this was handily my favorite season of JoJo's yet. I have high hopes for Part 5, but I've heard somewhat mixed things about the manga, so time will tell. If you so desire, you may watch this season of JoJo's Bizarre Adventure on Crunchyroll and Hulu, with Crunchyroll additionally hosting all prior seasons, at this point totaling over 100 episodes. But don't let that scare you from seeing what all the buzz is about. And that'll do it. Thanks for watching, have a great day, leave any feedback in the comments, subscribe if you want more. And if there's anything you'd like to see reviewed, by all means, tell me. I know for sure this review was requested by at least a few people, but I forgot to jot down their names since I had been planning to do it anyway. Sorry, guys. But thanks again, and see you next time. Hopefully, eventually, for part 5.